Good morning, everyone. Welcome to Kensington. We're so glad you're here today. If you were with us last weekend, you got to join us as we celebrated Good Friday and Easter and the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And last weekend we sang a song, and we're going to sing it today again. And what I love about this song is it just declares the beauty and the power of his name. So I want to invite you to stand and sing this with us.
What a beautiful name it is, and nothing compares. You guys sounded amazing out there. That is one of my favorite songs, and I love the lyrics, "Yours is the name above all names." And it feels especially relevant for us as a community just coming out of celebrating Easter together. Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Kensington. My name is Becky, and I'm part of the campus team here. We are so glad you chose to be here with us this morning, especially if you're visiting or if you're joining us coming from Easter. Well, next Saturday, we have an opportunity to move out into our community and make a difference together. It's a long-standing tradition here at Kensington called Spring Serve, and we have projects that will work for everyone, from some spring cleaning projects in our Pontiac partner schools to blessing some under-resourced families with light repair and yard work to planting seeds and pulling weeds and turning soil in our very own community garden that serves a lot of local area food banks. So this is a perfect step to put your toe in the water and try serving. There's no experience necessary, and we even have some great family-friendly serves. I know for me, as I look back over the years at the experiences that have really shaped our family, it's serving together. I would put that really at the top of the list. So sign up as a family, grab a friend, grab a neighbor, or sign up by yourself, and I guarantee you will meet some fun people as you serve alongside them. So if you're interested in checking out all the opportunities or you want to register, you can either do that online or you can head out to the table in the lobby with the balloons. All right, so we're a week away, or no, less than a month away, not a week, less than a month away from one of my favorite events of the year, and it's for ladies only. It's our annual Smash Women's Retreat up at Spring Hill Camps. Ladies, anybody in the room? Gone to Smash before? Yes? Okay. So ladies, this is an awesome opportunity to just get away from the stress and the pressures of everyday life, to be with Jesus and to be with your girlfriends, have fun, laugh. So whether you want to grab some solitude with your Bible or hear great teaching and worship, or maybe you just love adventure and you want to ride the zip line over the lake, Smash has something for you. So I really want to encourage you to consider it. We've got women in the lobby in pink shirts handing out these cards, but you want to go home and sign up soon because Smash sold out very quickly last year. Another thing that I want to talk about is an opportunity to jump in this spring and grow in your faith. It's called our Alpha Course. And to tell you a little bit about it, take a look at this video.
I would like to ask God what he's thinking when he looks down on us and sees some of the things that are going on.
Why are there so many denominations?
Why did God put us here on the earth? Like, why are we here?
Does the universe have an end?
Is there a purgatory?
I want to know if cats and dogs and pets go to heaven.
I would ask God if he's okay with gay marriage.
Did Jesus really rise from the grave?
How my brother Matt's doing. He recently passed back in March.
I guess I would ask him why he doesn't answer every single prayer.
Does everybody get to go to heaven?
How do I know Christianity is true? How do I know?
So our Alpha class kicks off right here at Orion tomorrow night at 6:30. It's an 8-week introduction to the Christian faith where you share a meal together. That means no cooking on Monday nights. You get to watch a great video teaching, and then you dive into questions like these at your table each week. So if you're interested in checking out Alpha, or maybe you know someone, they don't even have to go to church, but this would be perfect for them, invite them to come along with you. You can go head out into the lobby at the table to get information, or you can register online. All right, so we are in the first week, we're kicking off a new series called Bold, and Dave Wilson, our lead pastor, is here to take us through the rest of the day. But before we dive into the service, why don't you guys stand up? We're going to have people coming in a little bit late today, so say hi to someone around you, move into the middle of your row, tell people what you did for Earth Day yesterday.
Thank you. I'm laughing. Becky was being real nice. She said, people are coming in late today. She didn't say why. Because I went too long the first service, okay? Just telling you, I'm not going to go too long this service. I'm going to cut 7 minutes out of my message. You ready? Time me right now. Dave Wilson, glad you're here. What a week. It's been incredible week. We had Good Friday services Friday, then Saturday, Sunday, we had Easter, which was incredible. We had the stage set up like the temple in Israel. We had the Holy of Holies, the veil tearing, all that, right? And it's all gone. Because last night we had a concert here with Bethel Worship Music, which was awesome. The place was packed out. People were lined up for an hour to get in. It was nuts. Wednesday night we had a midweek service here. Friday night we did a worship event at 20 Front Street. What a week. It's been quite a week. And then today we start a two-week series called Bold, based on the whole idea that we talked about in Easter. In fact, a buddy of mine, I've heard now three people say this happened with them with a teenage kid sitting in the Good Friday service. We showed movie clips from The Passion of the Christ. Remember that movie? If you were here Good Friday, you saw a few of those clips. Several dads have told me their son or daughter turned to them after that and said, how did they get that footage of Jesus? And they weren't kidding, which is awesome. It's because they've grown up in a digital world, and they're like, of course there's footage of that somewhere, and we got it in the archives. Only Kensington's got it, by the way. No other church has that stuff. Anyway, so, and again, if you were here last week, here's the big idea of Easter. When Jesus died and said, it is finished, the veil in the temple tore, which meant, if you were here and heard me talk on Saturday or Sunday, I actually said it the same but different in seven different services. The veil tearing means this. We now have access to God, or we get in, and God comes out. He's not in a building. He's not in the Holy of Holies. He is out. And by the way, I said this last service. The reason you can walk in here today and everything is set back up to look like a church is because of that production team back there who was here till 3, 4, or 5 in the morning after Bethel left. Seriously, they deserve a hand clap. Because all the other campuses, at least I know Troy campus, still has the temple set up because they're leaving it for the series, and we couldn't because Bethel was here and they didn't sort of want the temple, you know, as part of their concert. But they were up all night here, 3, 4 in the morning, getting it ready for you. So God bless them. They're amazing, the sacrifices people make on our behalf so that we could experience this. So anyway, we find out because the veil is torn that we have access to God. In fact, I said, anytime you or I say Jesus, he's there. It isn't like we have to go find him in a building or a church or a sanctuary. I remember growing up in a church, and it's like I was afraid to get near the sanctuary because that's where God was. Like, that's not New Testament theology. God is everywhere. God is literally right here in this temple, the human body. If you know Jesus, if you've surrendered your life to Christ, he literally lives in you, which is next week's service. The whole message next week is, okay, if he lives in me, how do I access his power? Man, you do not want to miss next week. So this week is this. Okay, if he's living in me, it's almost like this. Pre-Easter was this, God with us. Post-Easter is God in us. Big difference. Seriously, Cody said this Wednesday night. I just captured it for you because that's exactly true. Before Jesus rose from the dead, you read the Old Testament, and God is with people, but after the resurrection, because the veil is torn and God is now free to be anywhere at any time, he is not just with us. Oh my gosh, he's in us. What's that mean? Next week, do not miss. What does that mean? But it also means this. If he's living in me and in you, and if you're not a follower of Christ today, you're here checking him out. God bless you. I'm glad you're here. I honestly believe this. I hope today's your day. I hope some dots are connected. You go, why in the world would I not surrender my life to Jesus right here, right now? And when a person does, when I did 37 years ago, Christ came. I didn't understand it, but he lives now in me. And he has a will or a purpose for my life and for your life. And so today is like, what would it look like to take a bold move to step into the will of God? Now, let me ask you something. Do you know why you're on this planet? I've mentioned Mark Twain. Cody mentioned it Wednesday night. Mark Twain once said, there's two most important days of your life. You've heard this. Are the day you were born and the day you know why. And he is right. Day we're born sort of matters because we come into existence. But the day we know why we're on this planet is as important as anything. It's like most people, in my opinion, don't even know why they're here. They think it's about making money or being happy or whatever. It's like, nope, it's so much bigger and deeper than that. And most people couldn't articulate what is God's will or purpose for your life. Most of us don't know. And maybe you've done what I've done. We're like, God, Give me a sign. Just give me a sign. Just tell me. Put it in the sky what you want me to do, and I'll do it. And so we begged God for a sign. In fact, there was a movie years ago, some of you saw, I saw, called Bruce Almighty. Remember that? Where Jim Carrey, I'm going to show you a clip. This is a great clip because Jim does what we often do. We're like, God, just give me a sign, and I'll do it. So enjoy this.
Okay, God, you want me to talk to you?
Then talk back. Tell me what's going on. What should I do? Give me a signal. Oh, I need your guidance, Lord. Please send me a sign. Oh, what's this Joker doing now? Okay. All right, I'll try it your way. All right, Lord, I need a miracle. I'm desperate. I need your help, Lord. Please reach into my life. What the heck? Where are you? I got you.
So yeah, it's a cute way to look at, okay, does God give us a sign? Here's what I believe is in that clip, and I think it's true. He does. I mean, they're not literally signs on the back of a truck, but God gives us signs. And I honestly believe this, God's going to give you one today. And yeah, it won't be a written sign. As God speaks today to us, if we're really looking and really listening, I honestly believe God will give you and me direction on what His will is for you and me in our life. And I'm going to pray to that end right now. Please pray with me, Father. Lord Jesus, I pray for a sign. Just like that clip, so many of us have asked you, and I think so often you've said, I've given you, and I'll give you another one. And Lord, I pray right here, right now, that you would speak, not me, you would speak, and you would communicate to our soul what it is you have us on this planet to do. God, reveal your will in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, here's what we're going to do. We're going to take a sort of a mini seminary class on the will of God, all right? So if you want to know what the will of God is, we got to sort of start at the foundation and then build that to get from God's general will for the planet and for you and I, to God's specific will for your life and my life. So you start here. If you want to know what God's will is for your life, you can go to the Bible. And if you're new at Kensington, we believe the Bible is the Word of God, not a Word of God, the Word of God. Every message, everything we do is based on the foundation of God's Word. So you got to go to God's Word, and you go to the one who was raised from the dead. We talked about last week, his name is Jesus. The name we just sang about, the beautiful, powerful, wonderful name of Jesus. That's why we sing a song like that here, because that's what we believe. And so we go to Jesus, and you ask him, and some of you know this, if you've read your Bible, New Testament, often he was asked, Rabbi, teacher, master, what is the most important thing we should know? They said it this way, of all the commandments, there's over 600 commandments, not just the 10, but over 600, what is the most important one? It's like, if you're from God, you can tell us, you can give us a sign of all the things I should do with my life, which one matters the most? In other words, which is mission critical, right? And Jesus answered that question, you know that? I'll read you one passage in Mark chapter 12. It's recorded that Jesus said this, the most important one, answered Jesus, is this, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Now, some of you know this, but he's quoting all the way back in the first five books of the Bible, the book called Deuteronomy. He's quoting the Shema, it was called, with the nation of Israel. They would recite this. They would teach this to their kids. Hear, O Israel, the Lord is one God. There's not many gods. There's not polytheism. There's one God. His name is Jehovah. We now know his name is Jesus. He said, that's who he is. Now, he says, this is the foundation. And out of that, he says, here it is. Verse 30, love the Lord your God with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind and with all your strength. And then he says, the second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these. So he said, you want to know? Mission critical? Number one, here it is. Hear, O Israel, you know this. This is the foundation of our faith. He says, love the Lord your God with everything you got. And then he adds a second one. I don't really think it's the second one. I think it's 1A and B. A is love God. Second one is love your neighbors yourself. What's second one? Love people. In fact, if you don't learn anything today and you want to know what is God's will for my life, I guarantee you it starts right there. Love God, love people. Love God, love people. People are like, I don't know what God wants me to do. I do. It's that simple. You can lay your head on your pillow every night and evaluate your day based on that. If I'm a follower of Christ, what am I supposed to have done today? Well, I don't know all the details, but I know this. Did I love God today? With everything I got. Did I even spend any time talking to him or listening to him? Did I spend any time reading his love letter to me? I mean, if you said you loved your wife or you loved your husband or you loved the person you're dating, would you go a day or a week without talking to him? No, all day long you'd be talking and texting and communicating. It's like, yeah, that's how I love people. I love them. And then out of that overflow of that love from God, from me, from him to me, I overflow that to people. He says, love God, love people, love God, love people. That's it. Jesus said, well, all the stuff, that's all that matters. If you don't do anything else, love me, love people. And by the way, it doesn't just mean people you like. He means all people. People you're getting, you know, behind coming in here today and you're all mad because you're behind people that are going too slow to get into Kensington Church, right? And the parking team doesn't know where to park yet. Love those people. Love everybody. That's it. That is the general will of God. It starts right there. Love God, love people. And then out of that, you have to decide, okay, that's great. That helps me, but I still don't know what he wants me to do. Okay, now, Seminary 101. Let's talk about the will of God. We have to understand three types of wills of God. They're called the providential will, the moral will, and the personal will of God. We want to get to the personal will of God. What does God want for you and me personally? But to understand that, we've got to start, first of all, with the providential will of God. I heard a message 20-some years ago. I think I was at a conference. I don't even remember. I'm at that age where I don't remember where I heard what I heard, but I know I heard this from Andy Stanley at North Point Church. He was talking about the will of God, and I never heard these terms before except in school, providential, moral, personal. Let's talk about number one. First of all, providential will of God. I wrote this down this way. It's what he's going to do no matter what. It's what God's going to do no matter what. It doesn't matter what we do, what we don't do. God has a will for the planet. God has a will for mankind that he's going to do no matter what. How do we know what that is? It's in his word. That's where he looks like, okay, what's the providential, never going to change, doesn't matter what we do, it's in his word. It's almost like this. A.W. Tozer said it's sort of like this. He said it's like we're on a boat, like a cruise ship, and we don't know where that boat's going, but the captain does, and it's going to a certain port, and no matter what we think or what we do or what we say, it's going there. And we're on that boat. We may not understand all the details, but the captain does. We can trust him. It's going to that port. Here's things that we know from the Word of God that is in the providential will of God. One of them is this. God decided, actually, in the first book of the Bible, we mentioned it a little bit last week at Easter, that he was going to send his son himself in flesh to save all of mankind. Are we going to change that? Nope. That's the providential will of God. God told us in his word that one day, last book of the Bible says, one day, all men, all women, all boys, girls, every one of us will stand before the bema seat of God and be judged for our life. And by the way, if that scares you, you better know Jesus, because judgment goes away when you know Christ. But he says, that will happen whether you want it to or not. Jesus said in Matthew 16, he says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. It doesn't matter what you and I think. It doesn't matter who our president is or who our president isn't. You know, that we got the Messiah in there, Donald Trump. It doesn't matter, right? I'm kidding. But it doesn't matter. You think, oh, if so-and-so gets in, the church will be shut down. If so-and-so gets in, it has nothing to do with that. God says, I will build my church no matter who's in office, no matter what country you're in. Even sometimes it's underground, but I will build my church. That is the providential will of God. Nothing at all will change it. So here's the thing. Oh, by the way, there's another thing that you might want to know about the providential will of God. And Jesus says, one day I will what? I'm coming back. whether you believe it or not, doesn't matter if you believe it, he's coming back and you and I better get ready. And so one of the first things we can do to understand God's personal will for our life is understand what's his providential will. Most people, even in the church, don't even know. They don't know. They've never read the text to say, what has God said is decreed from the beginning to the end. It will never change. Because to understand what God wants me to do, I first got to understand what is his purpose? What is his plan on the planet that I'm going to have to come in line with whether I agree or disagree or even know about it? It is going to happen. So you start there, the providential will of God. But then underneath the providential will of God is the moral will of God. I define the moral will of God this way: what God has already told us to do or not to do. In fact, if you go back to Tozer's sort of analogy, you're on this boat, and the captain knows where it's going, even though we may not know where it's going. It's providenced. It's going to happen. On that boat, God says, hey, my moral will on this boat is there's certain areas on this boat you should stay away from, and there's certain areas you should enjoy. And I'm going to tell you what they are. The captain has written it down in a text to say, you want to know what my moral will is? Thou shalt not. The Ten Commandments and beyond, it's right here. You don't have to wonder. It's clear. Now, we found out last week at Easter, right? We found out that people know what the Ten Commandments are. We had you all stand up. You want to do it again? Yeah, we did a little exercise where we were trying to find out if anybody was sinless at Kensington. In other words, if anybody had never broken even one of the Ten Commandments. I don't know if you were here, but one of the services, we had one guy way back there in the back that stood up all through 10. I'm not kidding. I was like, Jesus is here, right there, you know? And I found out later, I didn't know at the time, because we're like, how in the world can he be standing up? We found out later, he couldn't hear me. It's pretty funny, but because if he would have heard me, he would have been down like all the rest of us very quick. But so we have the moral will of God, and you go to the Word of God, and you say, okay, what is God's moral will for me? And it's pretty clear. I mean, not pretty clear. It's very clear. Now, you know this. It isn't always something we like. But again, this is our opinion. You have to decide what you believe, but I believe the Word of God is the Word of God, and it's God's standard for my life and all of our lives. And so I have to decide to surrender to the moral will of God. See, it's really interesting. When I was in seminary, early 80s, we had a guy come in as a guest speaker, and he had written a book that was very controversial at the time. Probably not even in print. Somebody asked me in the lobby, can I get that book? I doubt it, but maybe it is. It was a guy named Gary Friesen. He wrote a book called Decision Making and the Will of God. And the reason it was controversial, because in those days, in at least a conservative Christian church, there was a belief about the will of God, which was this: there's one specific will of God. There's one person that God wants you to marry. There's one college God wants you to go to. There's one job, car, you name it. It was called the dot theory. At least Friesen said in his book, it's called the dot theory. God has a dot for your life, and if you miss it, you're in trouble. So your whole life is like, God, I don't want to miss your dot. I want to marry the right person. I want to do the right job. I want to live in the right city. What's your dot? And Gary Friesen said, I don't think that's scriptural. And it was like, oh, what are you talking about? Everybody had always taught that. And I remember going, sitting down with Gary at a brown bag lunch. Bring your lunch in a brown bag and ask any questions you want. And I had a lot. And he said, no, the will of God's more like a circle. And we're like, what do you mean by that? And it's all in the book. It's very, very good teaching. He used scripture back it up. He said, the law, the moral law of God is very clear in Scripture. He draws a circle and he says, inside this circle, do whatever you want. Don't step outside of the bounds of this circle. That's God's will for your life. And people thought, that's so impersonal. He goes, oh, no, it's not impersonal at all. God is so interested in what you do. But he just said, I've laid down boundaries. He says, okay, I want to get married. Who should I marry? He says, let me give you some qualifications. If you're a follower of Christ, marry a follower of Christ. Why would you marry somebody that's not living out the most important thing in your life? So that's within that. Should I marry somebody outside that? No, that's not my will. My will is this. What college should I go to? Should I go to Ball State or should I go to Michigan State or Michigan? I know you already have an opinion on God's will for that one. But God would say this. Either one. Now, if you said, I want to go to this university that worships Satan and we sing songs to Satan every day, you say, okay, that's outside the boundaries. I know some of you Michigan fans think that's state, and some of you state fans think that's Michigan, right? It's not true. But he says, man, you know, if it's within my moral law, enjoy it. But there's things outside of his moral law. He says, if you want to know the will of God, it's never going to be outside of my moral law. I'm not kidding. I remember reading years ago, and it caught my attention because the headline, this was back before digital, this was like in a newspaper or a magazine, I don't remember where, but the headline said something, "Woman strips for God." That catches your attention. You know, I shouldn't read this article, but I've got to read this article. It's like, what do you mean a woman is a stripper for God? And basically the article was this woman took off her clothes and got naked in strip clubs because God told her to. And I'm like, nope, that would not be the will of God. Why? That's outside the moral law of God. God says in his law, do not get naked publicly. All right, you want to get naked in your bedroom or in your shower? That's up to you, but don't get naked publicly. That's outside the will of God, right? Am I right? Yeah, so when you read that, you're like, there's no way that's God. I've had people over 27 years at this church a few times come up to me and said, God told me to leave my wife and go and marry the woman I'm having an affair with. I'm like, no, God didn't. How do you know that? You can't tell me that. Oh, yes, I can. The Word of God has already told you that. Here it is. And so God's will for your life and my life somehow is going to fit inside the moral law of God, what he's already told us to do and not to do. And trust me, we don't always like what we read in the scripture. Do we? No, we don't. Often you'll read things in the scripture and you'll hear things like this. There's no way that that applies now. That was a different day and a different time. We live in a different culture, so it's all different. It's like, nah. They're principles, they're laws that are timeless, and they're actually, though we don't always believe this, they're actually for our good because he wants the best for us, not for evil. I'll never forget. And I, honestly, this is why I went over first service, because this is not my notes, but I felt like God led me to tell you this story, and some of you have heard this, but when I became a follower of Christ in college, and I'll shorten this down, I can't give you my whole testimony, but the short version is, after I left my home and went to college, I never went to church again because I didn't believe it, and I was dragged there by my mom, single mom. When I got to college, never going again. I'm going to party. I'm going to sleep with women. I'm going to do whatever I can do as the quarterback of that football team. I'm going to use that position to a really bad way. And so I was living the wildlife. Long story short, it was empty. I was lost. I was confused. I realized Jesus indeed did raise from the dead. He's the answer. I surrender my life to Christ. Which, by the way, I didn't know it at the time, but you want to know what God's will for your life is? There it is. If you're not a follower of Christ today, that's his will for your life. Give your life to Jesus. End of story. I love what Augustine said. He said, you want to know God's will? Love God and do whatever you want. Love God. You love God, do whatever you want. Because out of that love, you're going to do whatever you want. So that's God's will for your life. I didn't know that at the moment, but the second I gave my life to Jesus, that was the first step in living out the will of God for my life. So I'll never forget this. I'm dating a girl. I've been dating her 4 years in my junior year. I go to my mentor, Bill. By the way, every new Christian and even older Christian needs somebody to pour into your life to teach you and grow you. And so Bill taught me the Word of God, showed me what a man of God looked like. He was a married senior student, so I saw a Christian marriage for the first time in my life. And I was like, when I get married, that's what I want. I want what they got. And again, it wasn't a perfect marriage, but it was so different than anything I'd ever seen. It's like, that is a marriage founded on the rock of Jesus Christ. All these things are happening to me. That's what I want. So I'm hanging out with Bill, and I'll never forget. I would, be at Ball State all during the week, and then on Friday, I would drive to Bowling Green State University, where my girlfriend from high school and now college and girl I'm going to marry lived, and I would sleep with her on the weekend and then come back. And after about 6 or 7 months of being a follower of Christ, I started to feel, and I didn't know what it was, but it's called the conviction of the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit lives in you, we'll talk about this next week, he begins to nudge you and push you toward his moral law. And I didn't even know what the Bible really said about sex outside of marriage. I just knew I enjoyed it, and she enjoyed it, and we love each other, and it's right because we love each other, and someday we're going to be married, so there can't be anything wrong with this. But I kept feeling something in my spirit. So I remember driving back one Sunday night after spending a weekend with her, drove over to Bill and Corky, that's her name, Bill and his wife Corky's house, and I sat down and I go, Bill, what does the Bible have to say about sex and sex outside marriage? And he goes, you really want to know? I go, yeah, I think I need to know. And I'll never forget, I learned that day, you don't give people your opinions. You give people the Word of God because it's true. Everybody's got opinions. I honestly don't care. And you shouldn't either. Who cares what some man's opinion is? Does the Lord of the universe, the King of kings and Lord of lords, the one who authored my life, the one who gave his life for me, has he written a document? Has he told anybody anywhere what his will is in certain areas of my life, especially the moral law of God? Yes, he has. Here it is. I'll never forget. Bill took me to a passage of scripture See, what's he doing? He's not telling me what he thinks. He says, let's go to the Word. And I've learned ever since, always go to the Word, always go to the Word, always go to the Word, which, by the way, means you need to know the Word. You're making a big decision in your life, go to the Word. It will guide you. I remember one guy saying this, and I think he's right. 85% of the will of God for your life is in the Word of God. We're like, what? It's right there. Just go find out what it is. So I'll never forget. Bill took me to 1 Thessalonians 4:3. And this is the first time I'd ever heard this verse. Paul wrote this to a church in Thessalonica, and it said this. It is God's will. Look at that. There's the very term we're looking at today. It is God's will that you should be sanctified, that you should avoid sexual immorality. I'm sitting there going, oh, wait. What's sanctified? I'll never forget. Bill goes, oh, sanctified is just a religious word that means set apart. It means that your life as a follower of Christ should not look like everybody else's life. Your life as a follower of Christ should look different than what the world does. It should be set apart. That's what Jesus does. And he says, you should avoid, run, flee from sexual immorality. And again, I'm doing what everybody does, like, okay, what's that? What can I do? What can I do? Give me parameters. He goes, well, you're not going to like this. I go, well, tell me. I want to know. He goes, well, the word in the Greek is porneia. It's a very specific word. It means any sex outside of marriage, the marriage covenant between one man and one woman, is off bounds to God. Avoid it. That's the moral law of God. So I'm like, yeah, Bill, I don't like that. That's exactly what I said. I go, I don't like that at all. Seriously? Like, I'm not going to have sex ever again until I get married? He goes, you can do whatever you want. You asked me for the will of God. There it is. And then the next verse goes on to say this. He jumps to the next verse, says that each of you should, look at this, learn, very few people do this, by the way, learn to control your own body. What's that mean? I control my body, not my body controls me. Learn to control my body in a way that is what? Holy, set apart, and honorable to who God. Now, some of you right now don't even like me bringing this topic up. You're like, please don't talk about this. I don't want to talk about this. And I remember when I read that, I was like, oh my gosh, I've got a decision to make. Because see, I can read that and go, eh, that was written 2,000 years ago. It doesn't apply today. And it doesn't apply to me and her because we're in love. And it isn't just, you know, one night stands. We love each other and eventually we'll be married. I'm sure God is good with that. And Bill's like, well, the text is pretty clear. Run and save that for the covenant of marriage. And so I have to make a decision. If I want to know God's will for my life, I got to understand the providential will that's never going to change and the moral will that is really clear. And I remember that night saying to Bill, you know what? I'm going to honor God with my body. I'm going to live sanctified. I don't know how I'm going to do this, but we're done. I'm not going to break up with her. I'm going to have a conversation with her, and this is over. Long story short, I drive to her campus the next Friday, and I sat with her outside her dorm room. I wouldn't even go in her dorm room. I said, we need to talk. So we sat. I remember we were sitting on the floor in a dorm hallway as people were walking by. And I said to her, man, Bill showed me what the Word of God says, and I'm telling you right now, we're not having sex till we get married from now on. And I felt so good about that, and I don't even want to tell you this, and I didn't plan to say it in the first service, and I just thought, I got to be honest with you. I'll tell you exactly what happened. She looked back at me in that moment, and she goes, well, if God didn't want us to fulfill these desires, why would he give them to us? And when she said that, I was like, good point, let's go. That was it. I am not kidding. That's how weak I was. I was like, never thought of that. Here we go. And I came back, and Bill's like, how'd it go? Not good. I'm like, Bill, she made a really good point. Really? What was it? This. He's like, you think that's a good point? You were just following your bodily lust rather than learning to control your body. But again, he said, don't take my opinion. Let's go back to the Word. Now, I got to be honest with you. At that time in my life, I thought God was a cosmic killjoy. He doesn't want us to enjoy life. He doesn't understand my situation. And now I know better. See, one of the best things happened 2 weeks later. Maybe 3 weeks. I drive to go see her again on a Friday, and I show up early to surprise her. And without even knocking on her dorm room, I step in to catch her in bed with another guy. Thank you, Jesus, for letting me see that. I got to tell you, we were going to get married. I would not be here today if I'd married her. I don't know that, but I can promise you that. I am a divorced man with carnage in my legacy if I would have disobeyed the moral will of God, and I almost did. God gives you and I the moral will. Why? To protect us. I mean, I've just talked about the sex area. There's so many others. I mean, did you pay your taxes last week? You better have. Why? Because the government requires it? No, because the moral law of God in Romans 13 says obey the government authorities and pay your taxes. So if you're a follower of Christ, you don't have the option. You have to do it with honesty. Why? Because this is the moral will of God. You can take any topic you want. The will of God is very clear in certain areas. And I now know, trust me this, I know now, married 36 years, why God said, take that thing called sex and keep it in the covenant of marriage, because it's like fire. Within the fireplace in a house, it's awesome. Outside of the fireplace in a house, it can destroy a house. And I know you and I know better, and we know better than God, it's not going to hurt me. Oh my gosh. Look around at the carnage of just disobeying that one area of God's moral law has left in our life. And I'll say this, and today isn't a message about sex at all, but let me say this. God wants you in your marriage covenant to have the greatest freaking sex life you can ever imagine. You know what I'm saying? You're like, oh no, God showed that. No, God wants you to enjoy sex, love it, that freedom, hang from the chandelier. I don't know, just he wants you in a marriage covenant to love it. And he's saying, and I want that for your marriage, so trust me on this, protect that. Don't violate my moral law or that is going to be hindered. Again, I'm not getting excited about that, but man, so often in church, like, God doesn't want me to. No, he does. He has a beautiful plan for your sex life. And by the way, I was kidding about the chandelier. Don't go, that's biblical. That's not in the Bible. Okay, but there is freedom to obey God's law and the moral law of your life. And so God says, man, there's a providential will. There's a moral will. I mean, you know the moral will. It's pretty simple. I'll throw out two options. You yell out, what is God's moral law? Does God want us to lie or tell the truth? Yeah, does God want us to gossip or not gossip? Right? Does God want us to curse or not curse? Does God want us to be Lions fans or not Lions? It's in the Bible. It's in there. The lion in the land. Anyway, I mean, how about this one? Does God want us to keep all our money for ourselves or give some back to him? Yeah, well, you just said it, so let's do it. You said it. I heard you. Right? I mean, that's an easy one, but yeah, we're going to take our offering. I'm about at the end of my message. We're going to take our offering. And the ushers are going to come right now and pass that as I continue to finish up this message. But let me say this about the offering. I mean this. God bless you. Thank you. Because I know, like I said last week, you and I don't give to God because of a moral law. We give to God out of gratitude for what he's done. It's just, I'm so grateful to God. It's like, I want to say thanks at least in one way through money. And if you're new here today, you've never been here before, you're our guest. If you want to give, you certainly can, but you really are our guest. I would say this. Instead of giving, go to Starting Point. Out in the lobby after the service and say, I'm new here, where do I start? You start at Starting Point, we'll help connect you. So, okay, last part. We talked about the providential and the moral will of God. There's one more, and this is where it gets real important to you and I. It's the personal will of God. This is where we say, God, what have you made me for? What do you want me to do with my life? And it's interesting. I think there's a lot of places we go, and we're going to look at this a little bit in more detail next week, but You go to Proverbs, yeah, what is it? It's Psalm 37:4, where David wrote this, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. It's really interesting to think about this. If we delight ourselves in the Lord, if we love the Lord our God with our heart, mind, soul, and strength, we say that's priority number one. He says, do whatever you want. Out of that, enjoy and live within my moral law and do whatever you want. Now, here's what I encourage you to do, because I think it's very important. We'll talk again next week a little bit more about it. But to understand what God's will is for your life and my life, it comes down to this. I would say this. What's in your hand? What's in your heart? I use those terms to say this. What has God made you good at? That's what's in your hands. What are your gifts? What are your skills? What has God made you gifted at? Everybody's gifted at something. We're all uniquely designed by God. Ephesians 2. To do good works that he prepared beforehand. So I'm gifted different than you're gifted. And so we have to be able to analyze and go, okay, what am I good at? What has God given me skills at? And education, that's what's in my hand. Then what's in your heart is what am I passionate about? What's the fire in my belly? What is it that keeps me up at night? What is it, a holy discontent? I can't let this go on anymore. I've got to get involved. Sometimes that involves a job. Sometimes that is your life calling, and it's from God because it fits what you're good at and it fits your passion. And the other thing I would say is always get wise counsel. Don't ever make this decision on your own. And I think God wants me to do this. Good, go ask somebody. Ask somebody you trust, somebody that's wise, maybe somebody that's older than you, somebody that's got a little bit of wisdom, and go, I'm thinking this. They may go, man, that's got to be God. That so fits who you are and what you are. How can I help? And sometimes they'll go, are you nuts? Seriously? You're terrible at that. And you're never going to be any good at that. What makes you think that's what you're... I mean, you ever watch American Idol? They think they were made to sing, and you're like, nope, that's not what God made you to do. But they don't know that until they get counsel, and the counsel they get is like, they're wrong. Nope, they're actually right. And the same thing's true for us. It's like, man, what am I good at? What am I passionate about? Put those together and ask God and ask people, and then go that way. Last thing I'll say, the reason I'm standing here today is because of that. When I was finishing up college, I called my dad. Don't have a great relationship with my dad. Walked out of my family when I was 7, but called my dad to talk about my future. And my dad says to me, he's a very successful airline pilot at the time, he says, what are you going to do after graduation? He literally said, are you going to pursue football with the NFL? Because I had a free agent offer. Are you going to become an airline pilot? Because I just finished ground school, like my dad, like my older brother, to become a pilot. And they said, or are you going to use your marketing degree, that was my 4-year major, to go into business? Which one? And I go, Dad, none of those. And he's like, so what are you going to do? I said, Dad, I believe God is calling me and Ann, we're getting married, into full-time vocational Christian ministry. I'll never forget it. He yelled, are you crazy? You'll make no money. You're throwing away a 4-year education. By the way, he didn't pay for it. The football did. But he still is like, all that money thrown away. You're going to go with some little whim from God. I'm like, no, Dad, I actually think it fits who I am and what he's put in me and what I'm good at. And I believe I want to make a difference in the world. That's what I believe God was going. He goes, I'll talk to you later. And hung up. But I'll tell you something. I'm here today. Because I believe, for me, that was God's call in my life. Didn't even know at that time it would involve starting a church that you're now sitting in, and God had this whole thing. And you may be sitting there going, that wasn't God's call for your life. Maybe you think that. But I believe that God used gifts, heart, wise counsel. Wasn't my dad's counsel. If I would have obeyed him, would never be here today. And I'll tell you what, about 5 years before he died, he said to me, that was the best decision you ever made in your life. You're doing exactly what God made you to do. He didn't see it then, but he saw it now. And here's all I'll say for application. And again, come back next week because we're going to take the next step. But here's what you and I got to know. If you and I are ever going to figure out and follow God's will for our lives specifically, here's what you got to know. You've got to know the providential will of God. What is his big plan for the universe? You've got to surrender to the moral will of God. And then the personal will of God is so much easier. See, once we surrender to the known will of God, the unknown will of God becomes easier. It is. And there's how I wrote it. The more I know God's providential will, and the more surrendered I am to God's moral will, the easier it will be to discover God's personal will for my life. I know that's way too much to write down. But that's the concept, is if I learn the providential will, but here's the big question. Will I surrender to the moral will of God instead of fighting it anymore? Will I say, I'm going to take my life and line it up underneath the moral will of God? Why? Because he said so, I will do it. And then it'll be easier for us to know the specific will of God. So here's the application point, one word. If you want to know the will of God for your life, it's one word. What is it? You already know. Surrender. You won't surrender, you'll never know. Good luck with that. But when the second you surrender, I think it's like God says, all right, now watch what I'm going to do. The day I surrendered my life to Jesus, I didn't know at the time, but God's like, I've got a plan for you. You will not believe. Let's go. And every day since has been a daily surrender to say, I am still willing to put my life under the will of God and do whatever he asks me or nudges me to do, even when I'm scared to death. And here's the amazing thing. When you and I surrender to God to do what he wants us to do, we get to see the heart of God We don't see it until that moment. But when we surrender, we get to see what his character and what his heart really is. And it just makes us want to do whatever he's called us to do. And I tell you what, we want you to see that and feel that and experience that. So we're going to perform a drama we've done many times over 27 years. Some of you remember this. Some of you, it's first time. This is a picture of the will of man and the heart of God. Watch this.
Unbelievable. What a jerk.
Rough day?
Huh? Yeah, try rough year.
Hey, what's up? No, I can't do that. All right, we did talk about it, and I told you I don't have time to do that today. All right, well, if it's that big of a deal, just take care of it yourself. No, that's ridiculous. You have plenty of time, and you know it. Now, listen, you've just learned to manage your time a little better, and hello? Hello? Whatever.
Things not going well?
Yeah, you can say that again.
So you're leaving work early?
Yeah, those guys are driving me nuts. I had to get out of that place.
Yeah, Bob was out of line at the meeting today.
Can you believe that guy? I wanted to kill him. He's such a liar.
You know, Bob's going through some rough stuff right now. Maybe you could cut him some slack.
You know Bob?
I've known him for a while. He's a good guy.
You say so.
You know, John, you were kind of out of line at the meeting today yourself.
I'm sorry. Hold on. How do you know? Have we met before?
It's been a while.
No offense, but I have no idea who you are.
Oh, none taken. I know you've been busy with the Sterling Project, and kids are out of control, and things haven't been the greatest with you and the wife.
Now, look, I don't know who you are or what you're trying to pull here.
I just want to help.
You want to help? You want to help? Hey, I'll tell you what. You want to help? Get my wife to talk to me. That'd be a huge help. Or maybe you could help me close a business deal so I could keep my job. Or maybe you could just drop a bunch of cash in my bank account. That'd be a huge help. But look, if you can't do any of those things, then just butt out. Look, sorry, just, you know, freaking me out knowing all about the Sterling Project, and, you know, I'm just so tired. I'm stressed, and I'm sick and tired of working my butt off for all these things that don't get me anywhere.
Sounds like you need a change in your life, John.
Yeah, no kidding. All right, how do you know my name?
Did you know that your dad wanted to name you Robert, but it was your mom that wanted to name you Jonathan after her favorite uncle? And, well, we know who won those battles, don't we?
How do you know so much about me?
I know everything about you.
Oh, really? You know everything about me?
Every last little detail.
Oh, every little detail. Really?
Try me.
Okay. I'm going to play this game. I was in seventh grade. I had a crush on a girl named Sherry Rice. And I wrote her a love note. And on that note, I had three boxes marked yes, no, or maybe to say if she liked me. And I put it in her locker after school. What did I write the note on?
It was an Apple Hostess fruit pie wrapper.
No. Wrong. I wrote it on the outside of an air supply tape that I gave to her on Valentine's Day. So there.
Actually, that was your second draft, John. The first draft was on an Apple Hostess fruit pie wrapper that you wrote the day before on the way home on the bus. You know, John, you should have stuck with your first draft. You would have had much better luck. I remember when she checked no. She gave that note back to you. Remember how hurt you were. Boy, were you mad at me.
I was mad. Whoa. Are you who I think you are? You're. Oh, whoa. Oh, God. I mean, oh, you. I'm sorry. Hi.
Hi, John.
Oh, no. Am I dead?
Is that what happened?
No, John, you're not dead.
Oh, good. Oh, well, in that case, you know that thing I said to my wife last night, I didn't mean that. You know, the incident at the restaurant on Saturday, John, it was not my fault. And all those office supplies in the back seat of my car, I'm going to return those. I was just borrowing them from a little bit.
John,
I was just
gonna... John, it's okay. We can deal with that stuff later. Why don't you have a seat? Want to fry?
No.
I love these things. Let me ask you something, John. What do you think you have to do to change your life?
Move to Africa and become a missionary.
No, John. Sure can't see you in Africa.
Whew, good.
How about letting go of some things?
You think that would help?
The way your things are going?
Yeah, I suppose you're right.
All right. Why don't we start with your money? What's in your wallet?
It's just $10.
John.
Yeah. What? I did not know that was there, I promise.
Oh, hey, by the way, happy birthday. I see you got yourself an early birthday present.
Yeah, sweet ride, 2017. It's got a full entertainment system, heated seats,
customized stereo. A lot of nice extras, John.
Wow. Can't believe I'm doing this.
You're doing great. So, what's in the briefcase?
Oh, it's just some quarterly reports, laptop, ID badge.
I'll take your job.
Yeah, you can have it.
No, I'm serious. Let it go.
Well, you're talking about my livelihood here. I mean, I don't make a ton of money. I mean, I got family to support, you know, bills to pay, insurance, mortgage.
You do have a really nice home. I mean, especially with all the updates you've done. Me, personally, I would have went with Cranberry in the Den, but that's just me.
You want my home, don't you?
No one's twisting your arm.
Whew. I don't know. That's asking for a lot. I mean, you got my money, my car, my job, my home. What's next, my family?
Yeah. You do have a good-looking family.
Oh, I know. Look at this. This is... just a trip we took on spring break. Yeah, that's us there on the beach.
Oh, beautiful.
Yeah, aren't they?
Yeah.
My family?
I know it seems like a lot to ask.
Oh, you think? Yeah, okay. Fine, here. Yeah, I have my family. You know what? Here, just take this too. Huh? Now you got everything. There's nothing left.
There's one more thing.
What are you talking about? You got everything. Everything. There's nothing left. That's it.
Yes, there is.
What are you talking about? All there is just me, right here. This is it.
That should do it.
You want me? What could you possibly do with me?
You will be amazed.
Okay. You can have me too.
Feels better already, doesn't it?
Yeah. Yeah, it does. So what now?
Well, now we can begin.
Wait. What are you doing? I don't understand. I don't get it. I don't understand. What are you? I don't know what to say.
You're welcome. Just remember, John, these things, they really belong to me. I'm giving them to you as a gift. Use them wisely. It's good to see you, John.
Wait. You still have my life. Can I have that back too?
Do you really want it?
No. No, I don't. And so what do I do with all this?
Check in with me. I'll let you know. See you, John.
I love that picture of the Christian life and specifically the heart of God. Because that's not what many of us think is the heart of Jesus. And so we're afraid to surrender. We're afraid that I'll take our life and just crush it. And it's the opposite. I mean, Mike, who sat here and pretended to be John, wrote this. I honestly think it's one of the best drama sketches I've ever seen in my entire life. Mike wrote this years ago to capture that whole thing. And I love the line he put in there when, you know, when John here says, "You want my life? What could you do with that?" And Jesus, who I love, likes McDonald's French fries. Jesus says, "You'll be amazed." That is the truth. Today is a surrender day for somebody because you just realized this is the heart of God and this is you. And it isn't a life of bondage anymore. It's a life of freedom to be who God created you to be. He absolutely loves you and adores you, and he has a wonderful plan for your life. And that doesn't mean everything's going to be easy and everything's going to be just perfect. It means it may be really, really hard at times. And yet you'll be living in the center of his will, and you will have the power that we'll talk about next week of God, the peace of God. I mean, I'm sitting here watching this drama. And Mike's family's sitting right there, right behind me, Linda and the kids right here. And they're going through a family illness that is really, really hard right now, really hard. And I know Mike and they know that this God is with them and has a plan for their life, and they're living right in the middle of it. As hard as it is, they're in the middle of it. And I'm telling you, you can walk out of here and go back to your life, or you can right now, right here, say, "I surrender." This is your moment to realize this is why you were put on this planet. The reason you were born is to know Jesus, to love God, and then out of the overflow of that, just go do whatever you want and love people. And do what you want. Fits what you're made to do, fits what you want to do. And God will give you a passion and a drive and a purpose that will make you jump out of bed every day to say, I know why I'm here and I know the author of my life. So pray with me. Jesus, I pray somebody, even as we sing a song that literally says, I surrender. I'm down on my knees again. I surrender. God, I pray this wouldn't just be a song or lyrics. This would be the commitment of some people's hearts. They would, through this song, through this moment, they would surrender for the first time their life to you, Jesus. Some of us need to resurrender because we've drifted away and we need to come back and say, I resurrender, God. Would you do in me what you want to do? And would you do through me what you want to do on this planet? God, I surrender all to you. God, take me, use me to do your will. In Jesus' name, let's sing.
Here I am, down on
there singing with you, and I thought, this may be a little weird. I think some people today, and maybe even on the week after Easter, some things have connected for you. Today is your day. So I can't see you, but if today is your day, put your hand up. If today's the day you said, I surrender to Jesus, you didn't just sing a song, you said, I just surrendered. Whether I surrendered for the first time or I surrendered again to say, from now on, I am going to live out what I just said. Have your way, Lord, have your way. Anybody? Got a few hands up? I mean, look around these people around it. Again, I'm not putting your hands up so people look at you, but I want to acknowledge you and say, go for it. And those around these people that know these people, man, help them walk the walk they just committed to. Because this walk is not something we walk alone. We walk beside with people. And again, if you're new here, the way to start that journey is Starting Point. Go out there. We'll connect you to start your journey here at Kensington and help you find a small group, a family to do that with. And others of you are still processing this and think, man, I need to talk to somebody about this. I need to pray with somebody about this. Our prayer team be right here, right now. You can just walk forward as people walk out. Just walk forward. There'll be somebody, a man or a woman here, to connect with you and help answer some questions or maybe just take your concerns to the Father. And then come back next week. We get into week two of bold, which means, okay, if now I know his will, how in the world do I do it? I can't do it. Yep, you and I can't, but God can in us. How does that work? What's that look like? That's what we'll tackle next week. God bless you. Have a great week. We'll see you next week.